Okay, so today in today's class we are going to discuss about introduction to J2EE concepts, and especially we are going to see about something called servlets. So in the last class we have learned some basic concepts about HTML, then JavaScript and so on. So now we are going to jump into the servlets and J2EE concepts. And J2EE will have two main concepts. One is servlet and another one is JSP. So today we are going to start with JSP. Sorry, today we are going to start with servlet. And next week also we'll do some application with the help of servlet. Then we'll move on to JSP and database connectivity and so many things. So in today's class, we are going to see about the basic concepts of J2EE. Then we will see how to install the Eclipse and how to configure Apache Tomcat in applications. That means the Apache Tomcat application server inside the Eclipse. How to create static HTML pages with the help of HTML. Then how to convert the whole application into a WAR file. Then we will see what are the two types of servlet and which is better to implement. Then we will actually write a servlet program that displays hello world. Then we will use doGet and doPost method in servlet, and we will we'll also discuss the difference between them. Then we will use something called invoking servlet from HTML, where HTML we will give input through HTML. The HTML will send the input to servlet. The servlet will process that input and it will perform some operation and it will send the response to the HTML. Like, then at last we will see more examples on servlets, and then we'll convert the whole application into a Java documentation, which the Eclipse will do for us. So first let us move on to the first topic, that is introduction to J2EE. Okay. So, J2EE plays a major role in many companies, like, because everyone, they are moving from their desktop application to a web application. So for creating a web application, we can go for J2EE, because J2EE is a base for all the web application. But nowadays they are using something called Spring Framework, then Hibernate, JPN, so many things. But if you want to understand this kind of framework, this is the introduction part where you can learn the basic one, and the extension will be like we'll move further into frameworks like that. So to communicate, or if you want to make a communication between two computers, we need something called networking. And in Java, in olden case, they use something called Java networking application, that is Java networking package, that comes under java.net.star, where they use something called socket, server socket, then datagram socket and datagram package, and so many things are used. So then they use something called remote method invocation, where they will create stub and skeleton, and with the help of stub and skeleton they use to write a distributed application. So the drawback of this the olden way of doing communication is that we need to write a lot of code, and also it is heavyweight process. Like, that is, the codes are actually, it's a heavyweight process. And to overcome that, they invented something called a client server model, where client is said to be a web browser and a server is said to be some application server. And this web server, what web server will do is, web server will send the request to the web browser will send the request to the web server, and the web server will process the request and it will send the response to the web browser. So while dealing with J2EE application, the first foremost concept is servlet. And this servlet is a technology actually, and this, using the servlet technology, we can create a dynamic as well as a very big application. And like I said, here you see the client sends the HTTP request, the the server receives the request and the servlet will process the request and it will send the result. For example, consider a case. I am opening a web browser and I am typing the URL, say google.com. When I type that, what happens is it sends the request to the Google server and we are getting the response as the Google page. And you see, like, every page, when we are dealing web content, every page is created in the form of HTML page like this. And we will see like how to create this kind of stuff and how to do that in J2W course. So first step, what we have to do is we have to install something called Eclipse. So to install this Eclipse, first you have to just Google the Eclipse. So you can search Eclipse free download. Then you click on the link. Then it says like the package was released, a new version package is available. I can click here. And to develop an application for J2W, what we have to do is we have to select this one, that is Eclipse IDE for J2W developers. So if you click on that, you can see a different link like Windows 32-bit, Windows 64-bit, and so many things. And what my machine have is like Windows 64-bit. So I have just clicked this and I have downloaded here. And after downloading, we have to extract it. Okay. So this Eclipse is not a programming or it's not a programming compiler or it's not a programming stuff. It's just an IDE, that is integrated development environment, which allows us to develop some application. The main advantage of using Eclipse is that it can able to integrate. We can able to integrate many components, and we can able to run the application in a single box like that. So first step is we need to install this Eclipse. But before this, if you want to install this or if you want to run this J2W, make sure that your computer has the Java, which is already in your computer. Maybe first I will just check. So first I'm going to check whether Java is installed. So we'll just type Java C hyphen version. Yeah, so I am having this Java 1.8 version. So that's the criteria in which we have to first install Java, then you can use Eclipse kind of thing. Now I can now what I can do is I have extracted this thing, and what I can do is I can open that and I can see Eclipse, and you can see many things like configuration, drop-ins, features, then P2 plugins, etc. So here you have to double click on this eclipse.exe, where you can see Eclipse IDE. It will open, it will take some time when it opens for the first time. Meanwhile, what we can do is, first step is we have to install the Eclipse. So while installation, we have to follow this procedure, and we have to do that. So second step is we have to download the application server. So for example, I'm going to download an application server, say Tomcat. So I can simply type Apache Tomcat download. Then you can see the official page tomcat.apache.org. So you can just click on that. Then you can see at the left side, you can see something called download. And I'm going to select the latest one, that is Tomcat 9. Then I can download the various format of this file, that is I can download a zip file or I can download a exe file. So for this case, I'm going to download this 64-bit zip file. So I just click that. So it gets downloaded. So just open the Eclipse. Okay, so when you open the Eclipse, you can see the workspace will be allocated. For example, by default, the workspace, that is whatever you are doing inside the Eclipse, it will be stored in this workspace. You can change this workspace also. So let I make this as a default one. So I'm clicking launch here. So then I am clicking continue. So it will load everything. It will load an IDE for you. So it will take some time because it's loaded for the first time. Okay. So now this is the IDE. Here there is no previous code or there is no configuration as done. So what we are going to do is we are going to set up the environment, and then we are going to set up the server also. So server which is already downloaded, I think it's downloaded here. So first we'll set up the environment. So to run the application, what we can do is you have to go to file, then you have to select new, and you can see something called dynamic web project. So you can select that. If you are not able to find this dynamic web project here, you can click on other, then you can select something called web. In that web you can select something called dynamic web project, like that. So when you do that, for the next time you will see, like when you select new, you will see a dynamic web project like that. So you click on dynamic web project, and it will ask you to specify the project name. For example, my project name is like app1, like that. That is my project name. So I'm going to select. So similarly, then next task is like it will ask you to select default location. Already we know that workspace is like C:\user\JWL, then Eclipse workspace/app1, that is the project name. Then target runtime. This target runtime represents in which server this app must be like get executed. So you can have like Apache Tomcat, like that. You can select, then everything it will be same. Now you have to click on next, and it will show you like what are all the files will be there inside that. So you just click on next, and then the main thing is the context root. So this context root plays a major role, because to execute that or to get the URL of this web application, we need to use this context root. So I'm going to generate this web.xml deployment descriptor file. I will teach you like what is web.xml as we progress. So now you have to click on finish. So now we have set the environment for in Eclipse for running a web page. So the first, what we are going to do is we are going to run a static web page that doesn't perform anything, but it will show every content to you. Then we are going to move to the dynamic kind of steps with help of servlets. So this is the environmental setup. So first we set up everything. Now next step is we need to set up the server. Now actually I have downloaded the Apache Tomcat. So now I'm going to set up the server. So for that, I need to go to downloads. I need to get this copy. So I need to copy this. So I'm going to put it in D drive for our convenient. So I am pasting this content. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to extract this one. So extract to Apache Tomcat 9.0.13 Windows 64 kind of stuff. So Eclipse is a IDE, and this is actually the application server, the Apache Tomcat 9.3. You can see like Apache Tomcat, the version is 9.0.3, and you can see bin, CONF, configuration, lib, log file, temp file, web apps file. So this web app file is actually like, it's an important thing where when you deploy any application, it will be added here. So that's all about like downloading this Apache Tomcat. So you have to use this official page, tomcat.apache.org, like kind of stuff. So we set the environment for our application. So next step is we need to set the server. So you have to just click on this server, and you can see there is no servers are available. So click this link to create a new server. Click on that. And you know that we have downloaded the Tomcat 9.0 version. So we have to select. So there are so many versions. So we have to select Tomcat 9.0. If you want to use some other server like Red Hat, JBoss, or IBM Cloud, or Cloud Foundry, you can select that. But normally people, they will use this Tomcat kind of thing. And you can see the these are the information like server host name, localhost, server name is Tomcat version, like that. So I'm going to select next. Then, so I'm going to deploy this one out, so I can just select finish. So you can see the Tomcat version is added. Now what I can do is I can right click and I can select start. What it will do is it will start the Tomcat server in this machine. So it is started. Now to check, what you can do is you can go to the browser and you can type localhost colon 8080. Oh, there is an error. It's okay. Oops, there is an error. Maybe we should delete this one out. You can click on this one, select one. Okay. So let me delete the old one, because it won't conflict with this one. So click on next. So you see, like, I have downloaded the Tomcat in F, but it's taking C because I have the Tomcat in C also. So I can just change that. So I can select browse, and I can select D drive. Then I can select something called J2W tools, then I can select Apache Tomcat, then I can select this one out. So now it's selected. Now I can click on next, then I can click on finish. So now it's stop. Now I can right click and I can select start again. So it gets started. Let me refresh this one. No, it's not showing it. What is the problem? Okay, let me check this out. Okay, we'll check this out later. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a static web page out of this. So for this, what I'm going to do is you can see like plenty of things like a deployment descriptor, and you can see like error page, and this everything we will cover it later. And you can see something called Java resource where all the Java programs we can put here, especially the servlet program you can put here. Then I can see something called build where if you want to convert this into some archive file or maybe like web archive or other thing, we can use this. And this is the main thing where our page goes. So that is web content. So what I can do is I can right click this web content, I can select something called new, and then I can write something called HTML page here. So you can put the first page of the all application like index. So I just type index.html. So next one is we need to write some HTML code, because already we have seen in the last tutorials like how to create HTML and how to create like JavaScript like kind of stuff. So it is, let me recap. To create HTML, you need to have a HTML code. Inside HTML code, you'll have head section. Inside head section, you can have meta as well as title. So this meta is an optional one. And then you can have a body section like that. So here you can insert your own, here you can use a predefined tags like H1, H2 like that. And you can type, for example, for this case, I'm going to type welcome to some content like that. So then I can change the title as demo page like that. So now you can see the content is added. Now what I can do is I can click on this project and right click, and I can select run as, then I can click on server. Now what it will do is it will convert the application into a WAR file that we will discuss. We will see that in just a minute. So you have to right click that and you have to select run as server. Then it will ask you to like which server you want to run like that. So you have to select Tomcat version 9.0, then you have to click on next, then you can select finished like that. So this will refresh your server. Now you can see the application is deployed and you can see the output. So let me open Chrome. Let me paste this link. Press enter. Yeah, I am getting this static web page. So you see, like localhost 8080 slash, this is the context root of this project name, that is app one. So you are getting this in a correct manner. So to create any static page, what we can do is we can put that static page inside this index.html, and then actually you can able to execute that with the help of this Eclipse. So this Eclipse will have this configured server called Apache Tomcat version 9.0 like that. So then what we can do is this will just display the data to the user. We didn't added any dynamic content so that each and every time the web page will get loaded with the different content like that. We didn't add. But to create a static web page, this is the format actually. So now we'll discuss about some dynamic web application like that. So before that, you can ask about. Okay. So now we'll discuss about how to create a dynamic web application with the help of this Eclipse and with the help of the servlet. So you know this static page will only displays the data to the user. It will not perform anything like dynamic content like that. For example, the dynamic page is like that. If you give some input, the server has to take the input and it should process something and it should display that result to the user. That is said to be a dynamic way of doing stuffs. So now we are going to see about some dynamic content. So to create a dynamic content, we have to create something called servlet. So for example, we can create a servlet program here in SRC folder, because servlet is a Java program that is specially made for building a dynamic applications in the servers. So what you can do is you can right click this SRC and you can select something called package. First, we will create the package. Then we'll put all the classes inside this package. For example, package is nothing but it will help us to differentiate the classes. In core Java tutorials, we have seen like book comes under book package, then library comes under lib package, like that. We defined our own packages. Similarly, if you go for a user defined packages, all the networking application that comes under java.net.star. Similarly, all the input-output operations can be done by Java I/O like that. So everything can be separated in a different way. Like, for example, if you are working in an organization, how will you set the package name? For example, assuming that you are working for my organization called arulsuju.com, what you can do is you can reverse that name, like org.arulsuju.app, like that. So this is the way of representing a package. Suppose if you are working for an IBM, com.ibm.app, like that you can do. So now if you select finish, the package is generated. Now what I can do is I can right click this and I can select something called servlet here. Again, the servlet option is popped out here, but if you can't able to see that, you can click on other and then you can click on a servlet inside that web. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to right click this and I'm going to select servlet. And since I'm going to use the first servlet to display the content, so I'm going to set the class name as hello servlet. So other things are same because we are going to use the project app and the source folder in which we are going to place this servlet is src, and the package name for this src is org.turtlesuju.app. The class name in which we are going to use is hello servlet. When you create any servlet, by default it will extend the superclass called HTTP servlet. Then so it will create this Java file, will create a class file called hello servlet. So that's it about creating a servlet. Now if you click on next, you can see about the description. If you want to add some description, you can add here. Similarly, if you pass some parameters, you can do it here, but the passing the parameters here, it's not a good idea. It's not a good way of doing the program. Similarly, this URL mapping is like, this will allow us to identify the servlet. Normally, it's the same name as the class name. If you want to modify, you can modify that. So that we will see that when the servlet is loaded. So now we go, if you click on next, you can see like, since we are using Eclipse IDE, it will show what are all the contents to be added like that. So I'm not going to add anything. So I'm going to disable this constructor and I'm going to use doGet like that, because we know that the servlet has two main methods, doGet and doPost. So either we can select any one of this or we can select both of this. So I'm going to first demonstrate what is doGet is, then we can go for this doPost. So I'm going to just select doGet, then I'm going to select finish. So now what will happen is, it will generate a code for us. So you see like it's showing plenty of errors, like you see web servlet is not there, HTTP servlet is not there, similarly HTTP servlet is not there like that. If you find any this kind of problem, what you can do is you can right click this project and you can set something called libraries. Let me check where it is. Okay, so I think you have to use this file. Let me check. So I'm just right clicking this and I have to select properties, then Java build path. So here to run this servlet, we need to add some extra jar files. What you can do is you can select add external jars, and this add external jars, you can go to D drive, then you can go to JW tools, then you can go to Apache Tomcat, then Tomcat, and then you can see something called lib, where you can use like servlet-api.jar. So if you want, if it shows some kind of errors like that, you have to select this servlet-api.jar. Just select that, click on apply, click on apply and close. Now every all the errors gets cleared. Now you see like we have just created a servlet. You can see the package name is org.turtlesuju.app. Then you can see some header files or some packages which is automatically included in Eclipse. Then you can see this web servlet. So this indicates that we can call this servlet with the help of this name. Then you can see public class hello servlet is our name of the servlet, extends HTTP servlet. When you want to create any servlet, it must be extend with this HTTP servlet. Then this is an optional one, but for the latest versions, we have to use this version ID. Then this is the default constructor. I'm going to omit this one out. Then every servlet will have either doGet or doPost. So we will discuss what is doGet and doPost when you do some program. And for getting the request from the web browser, we have to use this HTTP request. And for responding the content to the browser, we can use this HTTP response. And it can, if there is no servlet found, and but we are sending some request through web browser, it can show this servlet exception, or it can show this IO exception. So both they comes under this kind of exception. So you can put throws servlet exception comma IO exception, and this is also like it's not needed. You can delete this one out. So I'll just delete all the comments for our understanding. So this is actually some kind of servlet. So now what I am going to do is I'm going to print something in this servlet. So to print something in a servlet, the first step is, what you have to do is you have to set the type of the response. So set type of the response. And the second one is print writer method or print writer object. So using this print writer object, you can print something in this web page. So first thing is we have to set the response type of the web page. Normally you see like all the web pages, the response type, it is in the form of HTML. Suppose if you want to load some documents in PDF, the response type is PDF like that. So what you can do is you can type response dot set content type. So I'm going to display everything in HTML. So you can put text slash HTML. Text is a main type and HTML is a subtype. So response dot set content type text slash HTML. Now I want to print something. So I can use print writer, then followed by object equal to response dot get writer. So it will show an error like print writer. So we can import this print writer by providing import java.io.printwriter. So it is added. Now it gets eliminated. So first I put the response as set content type as text slash HTML. Second one, I used print writer object. So that I will print something. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to print something. So you can use out.println. So I can type welcome to J2W by servlet. Then after doing that, we have to close this out. So out dot close like that. So we can set any name for this print writer. Normally in textbook you will see print writer pw equal to rs response dot get writer like that, but since in core Java we are using system dot out dot println, so I'm just putting out. Similarly, we will learn JSP, where you no need to put any print writer. We can directly print with help of out.println like that. So now everything is done. And I'm going to display this servlet. And you see here the servlet. We can call the servlet with help of this name like hello world like that. Hello world servlet or hello servlet like that. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to run this. So I'm going to run this, restart the server. So when you see, when I execute this, this will show only this index.html, but I want to display this servlet one. So what I can do is I can copy this web servlet configuration, including this forward slash, and I can paste it here. So I must delete this one out. When I press enter, you can see it's showing some other stuff. Wait a minute. There is some problem. It's not showing the correct one, so let me just Let me just check the properties of this server. Okay. It's using okay, we are using this D drive only. It's why it's not showing the correct one. Must execute this welcome to J2W servlet, but it's not showing that one. So we'll just close this one out. We'll just restart. Okay, it's showing this one correctly, but when I execute this hello servlet, yeah, now it's showing. So we'll get something called welcome to J2W servlet like that. So this servlet actually it is just printing welcome to J2W servlet. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to call the servlet from this index.html page. So it's very simple. What I can do is I can put a link like that, ahref is equal to we can call the servlet with help of the servlet name, that is hello servlet, because here the thing is hello servlet. So I can just type that. So then you can put click here to open the servlet, so like that. So now if we execute this again, if I refresh, I can see an extra thing like click here to open the servlet. If I click on this, you can see the servlet is open. You see the servlet is identified with the help of this web servlet name, and this is the context root, and this is the whole URL. Now we didn't actually put any dynamic content into it. So what we are going to do is we are going to just put some dynamic content. For example, this hello servlet will actually display some date. So we'll just add some date thing like java.util.date, then date d equal to new java.util.date kind of stuff. So now we'll actually print that here. So now I'm saving this one out. Now again, I will just run this. Finish. So now again, I will refresh this. So if I click on this, you can see the servlet will display the date, current date like that. So when I again refresh, you see the different the date will be gets the date and the timing will be gets changed like that. So this is how in a web page the dates and the times have been displayed with the help of the servlet like that. So now we did a very small program on how to display some content into this servlet and how to display the date into this servlet. Now actually we'll move on to some theory topic about the servlet. So you see, like servlet, it's just an it's an interface. Like we can develop many applications, and actually there are two types of servlets are there, and one is generic servlet and another one is HTTP servlet. So normally people, they won't use this kind of generic servlet because it has only thing like service method. But in our HTTP servlet, we have two kind of steps like doGet and doPost kind of thing. So now 99.9% of the programmer, they will use this kind of HTTP servlet. Okay. So now when you talk about the life cycle of the servlet, we have three life cycle of servlet, and one is init, and the second one is service, and the third one is destroy. So we'll see on practical example of this one. So the life cycle of servlet, you can say it is init. When the servlet is initialized, you can see this init method. And when the servlet is performing doGet or doPost, then it is said to be a service method or service lifecycle. Or when the server is like out of scope, or when the servlet is closed, then it is said to be a destroy method. And we'll have HTTP servlet in which you can use doGet as well as doPost. And we will see doGet and doPost in more detailed way like that. So when you use forms, you'll use this doGet and doPost, the difference. But when you have HTTP servlet, you can have only doGet and doPost kind of methods to service the request. Okay, so the question in the chat is like whether doGet and doPost methods are same. No, actually, when we deal form data, I will tell you like what is doGet and doPost. If the HTML form uses the action called doGet, we have to use doGet here. Suppose if it uses doPost, we have to if it uses post, we have to use doPost. So when we go for a form, HTML form, you will understand what is the difference between doGet and doPost like that. So this is actually a main thing in servlet. So this will perform both request and response for any given request. So these are the main steps. So first we have to set the response content type as text/HTML. Then print writer is used to print something. It's similar to system.out.println, but in system.out.println, it will print that in console. This print writer, it will print this in a web page like that. Now, if you want to make this more dynamic, what I'm going to do is I'm going to pass some value from this HTML page to that servlet program. Okay, so we'll do that. Or you just give some application, we'll do that. So tell me some application where you can type the content, you can type the data in HTML form, where the servlet will process the data and it will send the response to the servlet, or it will send the response to this HTML. Can you just give some application? Maybe we can do that. No, creating an email account, that we can do, but we need to create we need to connect with the database like that. So we'll do that in next week. But just tell me, like, for example, I will just tell you one idea. Maybe you can take, but you have to give some different applications so that we can try. So for example, consider the HTML page where you are asked to enter the Celsius value. The Celsius value will be taken from HTML page. It will pass to the servlet. The servlet will take the Celsius value and it will convert that into Fahrenheit, and it will display Celsius to Fahrenheit conversion. So like this kind of application, you just tell me some application so we can develop that kind of stuff. But for creating an email account like that, we need to have a database kind of thing, like a signup operation. Once the signup is performed, the data will be stored in the database. Then again, it can help us to, which we can able to validate with the help of login page. So tell me some different application, like a basic one, like I said. So we'll do that. So we'll try to do that with the help of doGet as well as doPost. Yeah, like passing values. We will pass the values through HTML. The HTML will pass to the servlet. The servlet will process that and it will show the result. Like that, like kind of stuff we have to do. So as I said, you can see these are the two files, two import things. If you want to use a generic thing, you have to use import javax.servlet.star. If you want to use a HTTP servlet, you can use import javax.servlet.http.star, like that. And each,
when you go for HTTP servlet, you can have a doGet or doPost, and each will have a HTTP servlet request and as well as HTTP servlet response. Like I said, we have to set the response type as response type, set content type as text/HTML. Then to print something, we have to use SprintWriter. Okay, you got some idea? We'll develop some application. Just type in chat, we will do that. Okay, so you have asked to like to create some application that converts height from centimeter to millimeter. Okay, so that is 1 centimeter equal to how many? So that is 100 centimeter equal to 1 meter, right? Okay, so we'll develop some application. So what the HTML will do is the HTML will get the centimeter value and it will convert that into a meter and it will display. So let me change the content. So conversion of CM to conversion of CM to M. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a form. So form action equal to, so whenever I submit this form data, it should go to this hello servlet. Then I'm going to start with the method get. Okay, so now I'm going to get some value from the user, so I can type enter the meter value. Input type equal to, so input type equal to text, name equal to CM, that is centimeter. So input the centimeter value like that. So input type equal to text, name equal to centimeter, then br, it's for break line, it will print that in the next line. Then to submit this one out, so I can put input type equal to submit, value equal to, I can put convert. So this input type equal to submit will actually submit the HTML form, but the value for that button I'm going to change from submit to convert. So this is the thing. So this I modified in HTML code. So now I'm going to save this. I'm going to run this. I have not done any servlet program. First, let me check with the HTML code. So you can see like this conversion of centimeter to meter. So I have to type the centimeter value, for example, like 200. If I click on convert, it should call the servlet and it should pass the value as centimeter value like that. As you see here, if I type 200 here, if I click on convert, you see the parameter of this value of this HTML form data is appended in the URL. It will be like this. So the servlet in which we are going to request, question mark, the parameter in which we are going to pass. So actually we are going to pass the value as CM and actual value is 200. So if you use method equal to get, the value, the form data will be appended in the URL. If you use method equal to post, the value will not be appended in the URL. So that is the first difference actually. Now you see like by default we used doGet, but we can modify that to post also, but for the time being we are going to run this doGet. So now here in the servlet program, now actually this form actually sends the data to the servlet program. Now I'm going to receive this here. So to receive this, I need to write a new code. Let me delete all this one out. So I'm going to convert, I'm going to get the value of CM here. So input CM is equal to get the value, I can use request.get parameter. and the parameter in which I am going to get is cm. So the parameter in which I am going to get is cm, and I am going to pass or I am going to store the cm into a variable called cm. Okay, but when you can get that with the help of request.get parameter. So it will get the parameter called cm and it will store in cm here. But you see it shows an error. The error is like whenever the HTML sends the data to the servlet, the data type of this is said to be a string, but we are assigning that string into an integer. So that is not valid. So we need to convert this into integers by using integer dot parseInt like that. So which will convert the given value in which will convert the given thing in integer. Now it is not showing any error. Now we have to convert this centimeter into meter. So let me use a double for that. Double m is equal to cm by 100. That is the formula. Now using this out dot println, actually I will print the value. So println the values in meter is plus m like that, same as the core Java code system.out. So the values in meter is plus m. So this will actually print the converted value from centimeter to meter. So let me start this, save, next, finish, restart the server. So you see, I will just refresh. If I give 100 as the value, if I click on convert, you see the value in meter is 1. So if I give 500 or 5000 maybe, the value is 50. But you see each and every time when you pass the data, it is appended in the URL. Assuming that your login page is created in form, HTML form, and you are passing with the help of the action called get. What happened is your login username and the password will be appended in the URL. So that is not actually good. So to overcome that, they will go for something called post. So instead of get, they can use something called post. Similarly, instead of in a servlet, instead of get, do get, they can use something called do post. Now let me execute this again. So let me execute this again. So I'll get enter the centimeter value. So where I will put 500. If I click on convert, I will get 50. But you see there is no URL, there is no form data is appended in the URL. So that is the difference between get and post. So if you use get, the form data will be appended in the URL. If you use post, the form data will not be appended in the URL. And for the security reason, people, they will prefer post kind of thing. If you or other ways, if you want to post some content into the, or if you want to send some data to the server, we can use post. Or if you want to retrieve some content from the server or servlet, we can use get like that. And the data in which you want to send with get is limited to 1024 bytes, but for the post it is unlimited like that. So now people actually will prefer some kind of post kind of steps. If you use post here, you must use post here. If you use do get here, it will show you an error. Maybe if you check, I will show. So I am passing the HTML form with help of do post, or I'm passing this HTML with the help of the method post, but actually I am receiving the value with the help of get. So now what will happen is it will show an error like that. So let me execute this again. So while executing the HTML, it will not show any error. For example, if you take 100, if you click on convert, you say that HTTP method post is not supported by this URL. That means this HTTP servlet is using doGet. So we have to convert this to post. So now if you execute this again, we'll get the result. Okay. So this is how we can create a dynamic web application with the help of this servlet. So what, let me check with the content. So we have completed installing Eclipse, we have configured the servlet, we have created a static page. So we'll deploy that with the help of var file. Then we have seen types of servlet, then we have created a servlet, then we have seen the difference between get and post. Then invoking servlet from HTML is nothing but this example, where the HTML, in HTML we pass the value of centimeter and the servlet calculates the meter value and it displays like that. So next, what I'm going to do is I'm going to generate a Java documents file for this web application. So my program is to convert the given program, like conversion of centimeter to meter. So what I can do is I can generate a Java documents for this. So the Java document will enable us to create a document, like it will show what are all the classes have been used, what are all the functionalities have been used, like that. So you no need to write any code. It will just creating a document for your project. So what you can do is you can create something called Java docs here. Maybe I forgot. Yeah. Source configure. Just check where the Java docs is. Let me check. Export. No, it's not there. Once again. Okay, so I think it's properties. Is there any Java docs? No, I did actually in the morning. So just right click, let me check. Java doc, where is Java? Oh, yeah. You see here, so I will just open this again. I want to create a documentation for this app. So I can right click and I can select properties. Then I can see Java doc location like that. So I can select this one out. No, actually, this is not a thing. So no, I will just check with that. I think it's right click. Okay, so let me check with that. Actually, what we can do is we can create a documentation with the help of this Java docs actually. Where is that? Yeah, you see, so I will click on this app1, then you can click on project, then you can see something called generate Java doc. Click on that and it will ask, like, if you do this for the first time, we have to specify the Java doc command. So for that you have to click on config. So in click on config, you have to go to the installation path of Java. For example, Java here, then you have to select 1.8, then you have to select bin. Then you see something called Java doc.exe. Click on that, select open. Now you see that to execute this Java doc, The command is javadoc.exe. I'm going to create a documentation for this app, and I'm going to use a standard document template. So, and it will be updated in here. That is, doc will be there. So I will click on next. Then it will add many things like a documentation title. I can put documentation for my project. Then I can click on next. Then I can click on finish. So if you select S2 all, what will happen is you can see the Java docs will be created here. You see it's loaded. Yeah. Now you see the Java docs will be created here and it is of HTML format. Now what you can do is you can go to this project path and you can take that. For example, it is located in C users like that. So I'll just go to C, then users, then this one out, then Eclipse, workspace, then app one, then inside this docs. So you see like in the docs, I can open index.html where the document is created for our project. Like I have used something called Hello Servlet. If you click on this Hello Servlet, it will show what are all the contents are there and what is the servlet name of this Hello Servlet like that. Assuming that you are using you are creating a very big project in servlet, what you can do is you can simply generate a Java docs. So the Java docs will show you what are all the contents are there, what are all the classes have been used, what are all the classes must be updated, what are all the classes are deprecated, like that it will show. So when you generate any project, it is better that you should use this Java docs. Okay. So we actually completed generating Java docs. Now the last part is like deployment of a WAR file. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a WAR file, that is a web archive file of this whole project. I'm going to deploy that in my Amazon web server. I have already purchased this Amazon web server and I'm going to convert this one into a WAR file. So to create the WAR file is nothing but it's a web archive file. The whole project will be converted into a single archive file similar to a zip file. And what we can do is the programmer, after creating all the codes, what he will do is he will convert that into an archive file and they will send it to a production server. They will put that into the production server and the production server will actually renders all the data as well as it will perform all the operation. So it is easy. Like you have to right click this app one and you can select something called export and you can select option called WAR file. So the web project is app one and I'm going to select my desktop for storing this app1.war. So let me save, let me select finish. What happened is the whole file will be converted into app1.war like that. So what I can do is what people will do is they will deploy this, they will take this file and they will deploy that into a server, in a production server. So what I'm going to show is I'm going to show you like how we can put that in an Amazon web server. So what I did is actually I purchased this Amazon thing. So I purchased with this IP address and with this link I can actually directly deploy the application. So I can select list of application. Then actually for the deployment, so actually this is the deployment page for AWS using Apache Tomcat. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to deploy this archive file, that is app1.war, and then I can click on deploy. So it shows that some space is not there. Maybe we should Maybe actually what we can do. Okay, so it's not working. So actually because of the size, it's not working. So what I will do is I will install the Apache Tomcat into my machine, then I can deploy it. So to install that, so we can use this Apache Tomcat. Just double click that. Just double click that Apache Tomcat, click on yes, click on next, I agree, then next. So you see that Apache Tomcat uses the port for shutdown port, it's 8005, for HTTP port, it's 8080, for AJP is 8009, then for thing like that. So we need to set some manager kind of thing like admin. So I'm just setting this as admin for our understanding, because I'm going to install this locally, but you can have your own username and password like that. So you can click on next, I can click on next, then I can install that here. So let me stop this server because it will conflict, because it uses same port number. Let me stop this one. So it stopped. So assuming I am the developer, I have developed all the code. What I will do is I will install this Apache Tomcat into my production server. So now it's installed. Assuming this is the production server. So now you can see this green symbol so that it's installed successfully. Now to check that, I can use localhost colon 8080. Let me press enter. Yeah, you see. So like this, you'll get a page. What I can do is I can click on manager. Admin is there. So similar to that, you'll get. So this is the deployment area. Assuming this is not a localhost, but actually I am using that as localhost. Assuming this is the production server URL. So what the developer will do is he will select the var file, then he select deploy option. So once it's done, it's deployed. So you can click on here and it will be deployed here. So it you'll get some, if you give 500, it will be converted to 5 like that. So each and every time when this gets opened, so each and every time it gets opened, you can see the sessions also will be there. Sessions also will be updated like that. So to deploy, so this is like to put the application into the server, we can use this option called var file to deploy. To undeploy that, we can just click on this undeploy, which will delete the web archive file from the production server. So this is how the industry works. They will convert this whole bunch of projects into it can have like 1,000 servlet file or 500 servlet file or 100 HTML file. They will convert that into a single var file, and they will put that into a Tomcat or the application server. The application server what I am using is Apache Tomcat, and you can also use JBoss server and so many stuffs, etc. So that's all about today's class. We have seen everything. If you want to have another example, maybe we can try. So we have seen every concept. So next week what we'll do is we'll create some complex program in servlet, like how to create a session, how to create a cookie, then how to connect with the database like that, we'll see. Then we'll move on to JSP on the upcoming weeks. After completing the JSP, we can go for something called Spring Framework, and we'll go for Spring Boot. Then we'll add some testing also like that. Then we'll go for Docker class like that. So many steps are yet to come. But if you want to learn the web application, this is the basic one actually. So that's all about today's class, and hope we can go for the next week with a session, cookies and other stuffs.